Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this penultimate session. I'd like to also welcome our panelists. This is, I think, the largest panel of the conference, which is fine. A special welcome to our guests from China, who have come here from the Future China Forum. Huanying to all of you. We're here to talk about India-China business collaboration for future growth. I mean, let me give you just one reason why I think this is such an important topic. Can anybody take a guess how much India-China trade has grown over the last, since 1993? Take a wild guess, 10 times, 20 times, 30 times? Nobody? Well, the answer is 200 times. India-China trade since 1993 has gone from $350 million, a very small base admittedly, to $70 billion in 2015. From 2000 to 2015, it's gone up from $2 billion to $70 billion. That's a 35-fold increase. China is now India's biggest trading partner, and India is China's seventh largest trading partner. As for investment, well, you know, if you look at financial trends, if you see a trend and then you see something jump, it means something is happening. Now, this is what has happened with China's investment into India. In 2015, China's investment into India grew sixfold over the previous year to about $900 million. And that amount was twice as big as the cumulative investment from 2000 to 2014. I'm not even counting the Chinese investment that is routed through Singapore. This is direct Chinese investment from China into India. I know a lot of Chinese investment is routed to India via Singapore. I met a lawyer yesterday, an Indian lawyer, who does Indian law in Singapore, and he told me he's very busy, and I said, what are you busy with? And he said, I'm busy with Chinese clients wanting to enter India. He's maybe here, Vivek Garpalia, is he here? Maybe here, no, okay. So that's what's happening with investment. There are about, well, more than 300 Chinese companies operating in India. These include big companies like ICBC, Huawei, Lenovo, Haier, Sany Heavy Industries, and Wanda. Some of them have investments planned in things like industrial parks, mega investments planned in industrial parks, as well as townships, huge manufacturing facilities. Then there are SMEs. There are at least 100 or more SMEs from China operating in India. They're already manufacturing. They're manufacturing toys, auto components, machinery, electronic components. On top of that, there are Chinese digital companies that have invested in India mainly through by taking stakes in Indian companies. So you have many of the big names. You have Alibaba. You have Tencent, you have Didi Kuaidi, you have Huawei and others who have taken stakes in Indian digital companies. Chinese venture capitalists have become active in India. In May, there was a whole delegation of venture capitalists from China who went to Bangalore.
Yeah.
That's an interesting development. So in summary, China's involvement in India spans the whole spectrum. You have the big companies, you have the SMEs, you have the digital and internet companies as well. Now, Indian companies have also invested in China, but a lot of the investment is concentrated in large companies. We have Girija Pandey here to my left, who in 2003 took the IT giant TCS into China as chairman of TCS Asia Pacific. Similar to TCS, you have a lot of other IT majors operating in China. You have big motor companies such as Tata Motors, Mahindra and Mahindra, some pharmaceutical companies. Some SMEs have gone in as well, but it's mainly concentrated in the large companies. I should add, however, that there are some Indian companies that went in and then came back out. For example, Bharat Forge and L&T, whose investments turned out not to be viable. Okay, as far as synergies go, on paper, there are fantastic synergies between China and India. Every Chinese leader who comes to India says, India has the software, China has the hardware, we should marry the two together.
Yeah.
I think every Chinese leader who's visited India has said this, so I should remind us. Then famously, China is strong in manufacturing, India is strong in services. Although Chinese services are picking up and India's manufacturing is picking up, so they could converge. But that's the situation at the moment. Infrastructure, China has a lot of experience, a lot of expertise in infrastructure. India, less so. I was surprised to learn that India has even a shortage of civil engineers. All the engineers in India now want to be electronic engineers. So we need more civil engineers. We need more technicians. China has a lot of that expertise. China also has capital and experience in building large-scale infrastructure projects. Also, China has a completely different demographic profile. It has an aging population. India has a youthful population. On paper, there should be an opportunity there. You could have labor-intensive manufacturing shifted to India, although there are other countries that also offer the same benefits, such as Vietnam, Cambodia, and Bangladesh, but they don't have the market size that India has. So finally, I just want to say something about politics. I mean, there are some people who suggest that politics, the awkward politics between China and India, could be an obstacle to business, but I'm skeptical of this view. I think the politics between Japan and China has been much more awkward, much more difficult, for much longer, and the animosities run much deeper. And if Japan and China can have a flourishing business relationship, I don't see why China and India cannot. And there are signs of it happening. So that is, ladies and gentlemen, that is the backdrop to our discussion. I'm afraid we won't have time for speeches. However, I will ask each of our panelists at least one question, and then I hope you'll take over from me after we've done the full round. Okay, so if I may begin with Mr. Wu Lebin. Yes, Mr. Wu, welcome. Mr. Wu is chairman of the board of the Chinese Academy of Science Holdings, which is a nice acronym called CASH. It's the investment arm of the Chinese Academy of Sciences. I think it's very interesting that such an intellectual powerhouse has also an investment arm. It owns more than 30 holding companies spanning high-tech industries, investment companies, consulting, property, and range of service industries. Mr. Wu, from the point of view of an investor from China in charge of Chinese state-controlled companies, how do you view in opportunities and challenges in investing in India?
Okay, what's that? Yes, thank you, Chairman. It's my pleasure to be here to meet partners, our good partners, our good neighbors. And Chairman introduced me. I'm the chairman of Chinese Academy of Sciences. I think there's another way to easily remember me, Mr. Cash.
Good.
Yeah.
Got lots of cash.
And who's Cash? Cash is founded by Chinese Academy of Sciences. And Cash. Yeah, who is Cash? Cash is founded by China. The new China founded in 1949, and 1 month later, the Cash is founded by our central government. And now Cash owns 104 institutes, and the three universities, and I think it is the largest entity for R&D worldwide. If someone of you found else bigger than Cash, please tell me.
Okay.
Yes, and Cash right now is implementing a strategy we call the interactive innovation. That means the innovation chain, capital chain, and the industry chain interactive with each other. And also, as you know, we are implementing this strategy. We need to dig a canal. This canal, also called the cash canal, between IP to IPO. So the IP ocean to IPO ocean. And we are taking line measurements to pave and dig this canal. And the one of these line measurements is to have a platform for investment. And there are two ways for investment. One is strategic investment. And the other way is to run and control the investment company, GP company. So far, cash has 30 funds. Total size is about 90 million. Billion. Yeah, 90 billion. RMB, not the US dollar, RMB, yeah. So, and in the cash, in the canal, we are shipping the products. What kind of products is emerging industries, including the quantum communication industry, and the photon industry, and the ion industry. And also, very important here is the clean energy industry. And so the question you ask me, what our intending investment to India? And I think probably it lists several potential possibility for us. One is the national economy. And now we have the investment in last western coast of America. And to have the shale gas converted to methanol and the ship the methanol back to Asia, to our country, and also including India. Mm-hmm. And also right now we are reaching out to find some partners in India to share this opportunity to have the clean energy, to have the, you know, not only to make money, and also to have to guarantee our skies blue sky. So share the clean air and the clean water. So that's our opportunities we wanted to share with India partners. Thank you.
Thank you. So you're basically saying your main focus is clean energy. Mm-hmm. That's your main focus of your investments in India.
Yes, one of them. Yeah, one of them.
There are many others. You have someone else from CAC here, so I can ask him about some of the other investments.
Oh, yeah, you mean?
Mr. Wanger.
Yes. And also my colleagues here, also, he's our Maya subsidiary company.
Right.
And you know, we have some subsidiary companies. Someone is famous, just like you mentioned, Lenovo. And also one of our dot companies is the Wanger. He is my colleague. He's in charge of the business of One Belt and One Road.
Okay.
Yes. Probably he can introduce you some other opportunities.
Right. Mr. Wanger, well, since Mr. Wu introduced you, Mr. Wanger, as per the schedule, or as per the program, manages 25 holding companies and has invested in 40 projects. Spanning healthcare, internet, new energy services, engineering, among others. Right. Could you elaborate on the idea of the One Belt, One Road and how that has a sort of a ripple effect on investment opportunities for other countries, including India?
Okay, thanks for your introduction. So good afternoon, everyone. So allow me to introduce myself. I'm Wang Ge, come from China and working for Chinese Academy of Science. holding company, so attached to Mr. Wu's whole platform company. So far, we have two jobs. One job is to manage operation more than 25 different companies. And the other one, we chat for the venture capital. So venture capital, we have the two RMB venture capital and one US dollar capital, and another one is merge and acquisition. So far, we did a lot of job in the One Belt, One Road strategy, because in China, you know, in the past 3 years, so we grow so faster. But as you know, since 2 years and 5 years before, we get slowed down because every entity, you cannot to catch up and continue growth as a so faster GDP rose. So that is, we talk about is a new normal, you know. So that is very normally common situation. Thus, the China so far, we have the strategic purpose, wanted to put money outside and looking for the opportunity in the worldwide. So that is what we did so far. And looking for opportunity in the India, you know, India is a big country. So we really want to understand more about India. We know that India have a lot of population, a large country, and in the service and IT industry is very in the advantage in the worldwide. We want to learn more. And we have 2 points. The one point we are looking for the two fields in the India. One is, you know, in India, the IT industry is a very going faster and is a very best famous in the worldwide. So we invest a lot of company, and the company we invested, so far they are looking for opportunity into the India. And major field, I think, is in the mobile phone, smartphone industry. So not only include the hardware, but also in the software, the field. For example, the mobile phone, the play game, you know. So we find a lot of user in the India, so we can do a lot of the opportunity and a lot of investor in this field. That is what we are looking for. And the truth, and we get a very good, the benefit and very good interesting comeback in the India market in the smartphone. So that is it's my surprise, actually. So even we know the India have a lot of different people in the different area and have the different situation, you know. Some very rich man in the city and also in the country not have many money, you know. But we are looking, to my surprise, you can get a lot of the user in the outside, in the country, you know. Yeah. So that is to my surprise, you know. So that is what I can saw the one opportunity in the my first point. The second point, when we travel in the India, and you can to looking for, so the infrastructure is not as good as I expectation, you know. So I think we have another opportunity is to in the infrastructure, the telecom, you know, the construction, you know. So we're looking for some opportunity in the India market. That is my second point. The conclusion is we really, really to looking forward and to expectation, have the expectation into the India. That is what I thought. Thank you.
Thank you. Looks like you're going to be in India for a long, long time. Infrastructure, right.
Yeah.
Ms. Dai is the president of China Telecom in Singapore. Now, China Telecom has an operation in India, I understand.
Yes.
And it provides telecom services to Chinese-funded companies operating in India. Mm-hmm. But I read that you're also an advisor on smart cities, mm-hmm. that your team. So could you tell us what expertise China is looking to offer India in the area of smart cities? India is also building smart cities. Mm-hmm. And what things that work in China, would they be able to work in India, and what will not work?
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. I'm really very glad to have this opportunity to can share something here with our India friends. Actually, China Telecom already do 207 smart cities in China. I think China and India has a lot of similarity, like the population is huge, and I think we meet the same situation, like in a lot of cities, the traffic will be a problem, like in Beijing and Shanghai, definitely the traffic will be a problem, and population intensity very high in some of the city is still the same problem. Actually, in China, when we're doing the smart city, we think the most important part, actually, no city is same. Even have a lot of similarity, but we still need to know the city, understand the city, and share the city to the citizens living in the city. So actually, in China, because we meet so many problems, the urbanization bring the problems. So we have a lot of trials and the real cases in China. For example, like a smart traffic, smart surveillance systems in China. We call it Safety City in China. We already run more than 10 years in China. So actually, now at this moment, we are in India and providing some like a smart manufacturing or smart community solutions to our Chinese enterprise in India. And actually, at the same time, we are, because China Telecom as traditional telco, we still building the terrestrial cable because China and India are neighboring countries. So we already have the cross-border systems. China go to India, yeah. And then we can provide some diversity for India connect to US, because traditionally from India to US goes via the submarine cable. But actually now at this moment, we can provide like from India to China, okay, via the terrestrial one, and from China to US via the all the cross-Pacific systems. So actually, we can provide a lot of diversity to India, and the users in India, we can provide like including the transmission IP and also like smart city solutions. And definitely we try to build up like the ecosystem, because smart city is a very complicated concept, including a lot of things. No one can do everything, actually. Yeah. So as you just mentioned, India has quite a lot of talent in the software. China has a lot of the talents in the hardware. So I think definitely there will be a lot of area we can work together.
Thank you. Right. Very good. Mr. Pai, to my right. Mr. Pai, in your last session, they didn't mention that you are one of India's biggest angel investors. So I think we should know that. Now, you are sitting in Bangalore, and you have witnessed the influx of Chinese venture capitalists coming into your city, looking at the same companies maybe that you're looking at. Could you tell us what kind of value added does a Chinese venture capitalist bring to the whole internet or the whole startup ecosystem that you have?
Vikram, before that, I want to make some general remarks to set the context.
Sure.
India is a $2.25 trillion economy right now.
Right.
We're growing at 7.58%, and we hope to become a $10 trillion economy by 2030.
Okay.
China is right now about 11.
Right.
We were 10 years behind China 2 years ago, but China has now galloped. For the $10 trillion economy, we need investments of $15 trillion at current cost. Or a $13 trillion will come from India, because we have a high savings rate of around 28%, and it'll go up. We need $2 trillion more, or of which clearly we see $1 trillion coming as normal FDI from all countries of the world, excluding China. So there's a scope for $1 trillion of investment from China in the next 15 years coming into India. And it will be synergistic, because China has surplus capacity in infrastructure, it has surplus capital, because of the huge savings, and China has surplus manufacturing capacity and everything else, right?
Yes.
And India is a country which is very hungry. But China has done some extraordinary thing which the world has to understand. China, because of its massive production capacity, has lowered the cost of production to such a degree that every individual can buy more stuff.
Yeah.
If not for China, America would have had high inflation the last 15 years.
Yeah.
It's got almost no inflation because the Chinese labor and Chinese system of mass production has helped. Let's say in India, you want to sell a smartphone.
Yeah.
You sell a smartphone for 2,500 rupees, which China can do because of its huge base. You can sell 200 million smartphones.
Yes.
Because 200 million Indians can afford to buy. A billion Indians can afford to buy at 2,500 rupees.
Right.
So you have to bring it down. And for India to build up the base and bring it down is going to take time, whereas China can do it instantly. Two, India wants to create 100,000 megawatts of solar capacity by 2022.
Right.
Okay? There's no place on earth which can create the solar panels except China. China makes 20,000 megawatts of solar panels every year, and the cost is coming down by the huge capacity. India can easily do it. Our capacity is just about 3,000, 4,000 megawatts, so we need China. So if you look at everything else, India's need for infrastructure, India's need for capital, the fantastic growth potential, the young population is tailor-made for China to come in, not from the government side, from the private side. And I think they have to be very active because this is the last great market left in the world for the next 10 years. It's good for China, the Japanese are coming, and I think the Indians are looking forward to do that. Now, in the area of technology, in 2000, Zhu Rongji came to Infosys,
yeah,
and he gave a famous speech, like you said, we are superpowers in hardware, we are superpowers in software, let's be together. It's happening in a way, TCS, Infosys there, there are 100,000 people employed in China by Indian software companies. Now, China has built up a very large startup ecosystem, a large technology industry, primarily because they shut the world out. Now, Amazon is not there, Google is not there, eBay is not there, they're all out.
Yeah.
So they build that Baidu, they build the Alibaba, and they could do it. In India, we got Amazon, we got all these people coming and dominating our market.
Yeah.
We are in danger of becoming a digital colony of the West again,
okay,
because we are open, 100% FDI. Now, we need the Chinese to come and compete to take on Amazon, to take on, you know, Flipkart will compete on its own, and we need capital. So there's a way to synergize Chinese investment with Indian companies like Flipkart, like Paytm and others. It's already happening, by the way,
yes,
with Alibaba is investing to take on this big American beast,
yes,
so we don't become a digital colony of America or the West.
Yes.
So the opportunity is enormous. The Chinese are coming in now. Like you said, the delegations have come. They're trying to explore. But they need to tie up with good, credible people in India. Their problems of communication, problems of understanding, it takes time. It's a very different westernized culture. India is a very different westernized culture in business, and the Chinese have their own culture, they're used to a certain style, now they're coming in, and I think in the next few years, you're going to see an explosion of Chinese thing. What India can offer to China is entrepreneurship at the level of the West, deep technology expertise in very many areas where there's a global gap, a huge market, and an explosive opportunity. What China can offer us is the expertise and the experience of building large systems, because it's a very large economy, you know, billion people, you know, the, you know, startups. Alibaba is huge. How to scale up? It'll take time for us to scale up. The Chinese have done scale up as no country in human civilization, so they can come and give us to us, and capital to come in. We're short of capital. Now, we have a choice between American capital or European capital and Chinese capital, Japanese capital. American capital is coming in. The Europeans are too slow. They got too many challenges.
Yeah.
Japan is still thinking about investing in India. I wish they decide.
Yeah.
They've not been deciding for the last 15 years. And the Chinese, I'm sure, in the next 12 months will decide and come in. I think it's going to be fantastic, explosive for this part of the world. And I want to end up by saying, we must, as Asians, look at creating an Asian common market, not politically, not by currency, but by trade, so the whole of Asia can grow 2% more in GDP if we all just come together.
Right. So, Mr. Pai, just to follow up, you're not concerned about becoming a digital colony of China?
Right? No, we can partner with them and we can compete with them because we got the technology. And, you know, when they come to India, they'll work with local partners. And, you know, we can compete. That's not a problem. See, the Americans have got beautiful processes.
Right.
All right? And they got great capital. Okay, and they know how to compete.
Yeah.
The Chinese will take 4 to 5 years to learn how to compete in India. So that's good enough time for us. And they want to manufacture India. For example, Xiaomi is setting up a plan to manufacture in India.
Yeah.
Samsung is still not manufactured. They're still thinking about it. The Koreans are going to lose out. The Koreans came and ate the Japanese up in consumer electronics. Now the Chinese smartphones are coming. They're going to eat the Koreans dry because the Koreans are still very quiet. Because like I said, Vikram, India is the last great global market in the digital world.
Right.
It's up for grabs. China is welcome.
Yeah. Thank you. Very good. Girija, let's just focus a little bit on Indian business in China. As I mentioned, you were instrumental in taking TCS into China in 2003. It was quite an early time. We're talking about, 12, 13 years ago. There couldn't have been very many Indian companies operating there. So what was your experience like? How easy was it to set up an Indian operation for a big company like TCS in China?
Yeah.
So I think when we started at that time, we were looking at expanding in Asia Pacific.
Right.
So the Asia Pacific strategy, because the Indian companies are mostly in the West, and they know West, they understand US, they understand the UK, that was where the focus was. I think TCS was the first one which actually focused on Asia Pacific. And no Asia Pacific strategy can work without a China strategy. So that was very clear in my mind, that unless you go in, understand China, you will not be able to have an Asia Pacific strategy. So that was the basic.
Yes.
Having done that, we went to, I remember the first visit I made, not to Beijing and Shanghai, but to Hangzhou.
Okay.
And which is where actually Alibaba just started. I remember meeting Jack Ma at that time. Mm-hmm. Now, my view was that our global companies, because the Indian IT companies work with most of the Fortune 500 companies, were expanding in China. They needed a vendor partner in China. So our view was that let's do it three ways. First, we should use the multinationals in China who are our partners anyway globally and service them in China.
Mm.
That is the easiest way of learning. We had to hire people. We had to train them in our ways of doing things. We had to get the security right. So we learned from the multinationals. I remember the first deal we did with GE, which was a global company partner with us. Then our view was, okay, the first one is China for the multinationals. Second will be China for the region. Now, China is very well blessed because it can speak three or four regional languages. Up in Dalian, the Chinese speak Japanese very well. Near Korea, some of them speak Korean. And of course, in the south of China, Cantonese.
Yes.
So to service Hong Kong, Taiwan, Japan, in the region, we could use Chinese talent. So we set up in six cities, Dalian, Shenzhen, Hangzhou, of course, Beijing, Shanghai, and then did China for the region. And lastly, because the most difficult part of the domestic market, then we went into the domestic market after nearly 3 to 4 years. By the time we had 3,000 people, we had our Chinese team, which understood how we work with global companies. And then we went to the domestic market with products. So we did the banking software with Bank of China.
Okay.
We implemented the Bank of China's banking software. Bank of China has 150 million accounts in 27 provinces. Why did we get it? Because we did State Bank of India. These are the two biggest banks.
Yeah.
So I think that's how you have to use your skills to get into a market which is very competitive, culturally different, highly innovative, like India. Mm. So I think you have to use your strengths to succeed. And I think the companies in India, and then I wrote a book exactly this, how did Indian companies succeed? And I've taken five, and then we took how five Chinese companies succeeded in India, and we took the Lenovo, the Hire, the all these companies which succeed in India.
Yes.
That book is actually how do you build businesses in both these countries?
Both these countries.
It's like ground up.
Right, right. But your venture in China with TCS was a joint venture.
Yes, we first went in as a wholly owned subsidiary, what is called a WFOE.
Yeah.
And then we said, if you want to get on the domestic market, which is the real prize, then you've got to find a Chinese partner.
Yes.
And luckily for us, because the Tata name was so well known in China, surprise, surprise, actually NDRC, which is the main Chinese government's planning arm, asked us to be their partner.
Right.
So we had actually the main Chinese government as our partner. And it was a super ride with them. It was an excellent partnership.
Yeah, very good. Yeah, Mr. Srivastava, Mr. Srivastava is one of India's best well-known mentors and champions of entrepreneurship. You've been the past president of the TIE, the Indus Entrepreneurs, which is a global entrepreneurship network. If I may ask you. Do you see any potential for collaboration between entrepreneurs in China and entrepreneurs in India?
So I think there's a huge collaboration opportunities. Let me put it in context. I mean, barely 350 years ago, 50% of global GDP was China and India. I think 26% China, 24% India. All of Europe was about 25%. So the reason I say that is that you have two countries that have been very, very innovative and entrepreneurial historically. China's had a different trajectory, India had a different trajectory. For different various reasons, both of them went on a path which really did not encourage entrepreneurship. China got off the block quicker. Mm. So it's gone faster. It's built many of the elements that it needs to take for businesses to grow and succeed, and it built its market faster. We have to recognize that in India, the process is barely 2 decades old. So wherever we are, it looks great. The IT industry we were talking about, when I founded NASSCOM, we were a $50 million industry 25 years ago. What was my vision? That someday we'll be a $1 billion industry. Last year we crossed 160 billion. All entrepreneurs, except for TCS, except for the Tatas,
all
first generation entrepreneurs, right? So if you look at that, the scale and pace at which entrepreneurship has blossomed in India, not just in digital, we hear a lot about the poster boys, Flipkart and whatever, but let me tell you, phenomenal innovation is going on in other areas, in healthcare, in medical devices. And in many ways, if you look at China and India, the problems that entrepreneurs are trying to solve are very similar. Mm. Silicon Valley is solving a set of problems for a lot of people in the West, for those markets. Yes, the entrepreneurs in China and India who are doing the same thing as well, but there's nobody in Silicon Valley or Europe that's attempting to solve through innovation the challenges that are in India and China on scale. That will only happen in India and China. And I think the opportunity to collaborate is absolutely huge. It's a pity I find that there's so little of it. And partly it's our own fault because we've been very focused westward. All of us have studied in the US, lived there. So, you know, Silicon Valley seems like one more city after Delhi. Most of us do not have those links in China. You know, we don't speak the language, and that's come in the way. But when I interact with entrepreneurs in China, and increasingly I do that in India, I find that they're bringing a lot of innovation, sometimes in very similar ways, to solve the problems. For example, in India, you have this big problem on, let's say, logistics, transportation. There's an Indian company which has come up with a model which is a mix of technology, telecommunications, but fundamentally a business model, which will completely disrupt how the trucking industry works in the whole world.
I see.
They've done it because of the challenge in India of there's no large transportation company, it's fragmented, so they've found a way to change it. They're applying the airline model of hub and spoke to this industry. In 3.5 years' time, without owning any truck, they are the largest transportation company.
The largest?
Transportation company today,
wow.
Right?
Which one?
They move more baggage than anyone else. So what I wanted to say is, I think both India and China have a strong entrepreneurial DNA. They know how to solve problems on scale, because we have scale in both countries, right? I think there's lots of room for collaboration. I'm not the least worried about competition, because both entrepreneurs will find a way to leverage each other's markets. Everybody said when 25 years ago, when we were telling the Indian government from the software industry, please remove import duties, please open the field for all foreign companies to come to India. In those days, the government asked us, saying, do you know what you're saying? Because, you know, they'll compete with you. And we said, you know, we can deal with it.
Okay.
We did okay. Yeah. So to my mind, we'll both gain. I'm not worried about competition.
Okay. That's great. Mm. Yeah. Mm. Mr. Chau Sai Wale, in your last presentation, you talked about the help that the government is giving to startups in India. But I want to take you back to your other role as the head of the foreign affairs of the BJP. In that capacity, you helped to connect with the Indian diaspora in many countries, in the US and Australia, in the UK, in Singapore as well, and this is a way for you to build bridges with between that country and India, and you've done a great job of that. However, you don't really have a diaspora in China, not much of a diaspora, Indian diaspora. So how do you tell the Indian story in China?
That's always a tough, but we have some presence in China, especially in the Guangzhou. Also, there is a good amount of people who are in the jewelry business. They do very frequent travelers to China. Of course, there is a IT community, and also in some industries, there are some diaspora. For example, when Prime Minister Modi went to Shanghai, you will be surprised that we had a diaspora get together of 5,000 people there in Shanghai. So it's not that insignificant. But after saying that, yes, I agree with you that the India story, which is typically sold with the help of diaspora in most of the countries, that may not be possible to that extent in China. Therefore, more efforts needs to be done at the government level and also at the media level to tell about India in China.
Right. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Well, we have few minutes left. There are some questions from the audience. Let me start with one of them. For Mr. Wu, I think Mr. Wang could also answer this, but it's addressed to you, sir. What is your investment strategy in underdeveloped countries with huge untapped natural resources under One Belt, One Road?
I think that for the Belt and the Road, we have the strategy. First, we would like to meet the demand, the local demand. And the secondary, we need to have try to make complementary advantages. And then try to make more collaboration, less compete, and then to have the win-win strategy, especially for the high-end of high-tech industries. And including some IT infrastructure and also some brand new high-tech industries, including, I mentioned, the clean energy, the photon industry, our ion industry, and also the quantum communication industry, such as, yes.
Mr. Wang, would you like to add something to that?
Sure. I wanted to additional information is, our background is Chinese Academy of Science. That is a top organization in ministry level organization in China for nature science development. So we have more than 100 different institutes, and we have more than 150,000 scientists working for this organization.
Okay.
Yeah, so our investor strategy, so we wanted to cooperate with the India, is we're looking for some company have the elements for the hard and the software or had the technology. So that is what we like. So because in that way, we can to cooperate, use our advantage and to help each other. That is what we think.
Thank you. Mr. Lee, I must not leave you out. You're a very important participant, because Singapore has excellent relations with both China and India, which is a unique situation. How can Singapore benefit, or how can Singapore help to synergize these two big giant economies? And how can Singapore make it a win-win for all three?
Well, thanks, Vikram. I first visited China in 96, so this is a good 20 years. And first visited India in 2002, so that's good 14 years. And I must say that as I follow the two giants' development, I can see great transformation in China. in many areas. I wish I could tell you all, because we spent the past 1.5 days over at Shangri-La to go into detail on those areas of transformation, including they producing the largest company in automobile, in Alibaba, some of the 10 or so industries that are now grossly over capacity, right? Whereas for India, the development is not so fast, but nevertheless it's steady, and is supported by a young demographic, as some of the speakers have mentioned. And also you can see this rising trade from the two countries, from 250 billion, as you mentioned, to 70B. Now, Singapore has got major investment. Singapore happens to be the largest source of foreign direct investments in the last 3 years in China. And cumulatively, I think we have in excess of 70 BUS into China. And with India, it's not bad too.
You know, the biggest, actually. Singapore's overtaken Mauritius.
Yes, yes. I mean, but cumulatively, we also have 43 billion. So if you look at these numbers, it is pointing to a scenario where China, India are increasing their contact. They trade directly, they invest directly. Nevertheless, it is done so in the rising investment and trade throughout Asia. And Singapore, if you like, if you go out to our sea, you see all these vessels passing by. A lot of them are calling on the Indian ports, maybe Mumbai, maybe Chennai, onto Shanghai and the Ningpo port and so on. So there's a lot of trade. Now, I think where we haven't got much time to talk about is really the how to do it part. Because, we have businesses in Singapore and specializing in the Chinese market. And they find that the Chinese market is doable, but it's not so simple. You know, there's still quite a bit of cultural nuances and practices that are quite characteristic of the Chinese market. And in India, and of course, you know, our ambassador is very well versed in the Indian market, and so are many businessmen. You know, we talk about township development and so on, because some of these projects also, they are done in a very unique Indian way, quite unlike Singapore, quite unlike China. Then the question is, if TCS goes to China, it has got some Singapore DNA in it, I believe that will help accelerate the process. So likewise, many of the Chinese companies who are basing the headquarters here, they structure their companies to invest in India through Singapore. They bring along the Singapore DNA and know-how. I think that will also accelerate the investments. My last point on the table is really, I think, urbanization is a big drive for both China and for both India. And urbanization, as Lin has earlier suggested, smart city, it has got so many components on clean water, on green energy, on traffic management, on telecoms, on education, on public housing. And in each of these components, I think it promises great potential market for our businesses.
Right. Just a further question. By the way, did India come up during the Future China Forum? Was India mentioned at all?
Maybe, I don't think so. That's why we came up with this idea, because it is maybe a coincidence to have the two conferences held concurrently in Singapore. But you think about it, maybe it is not, because when the British Indies Company was set up through India and Singapore, the whole objective was to buy more tea leaves and porcelain from China. Mm. You know, so that traditional role has always been there. And of course, today it has evolved into foreign direct investments being structured through Singapore into each other country. So we find that there is perhaps a need for such a forum in future to coincide and to have certain section to discuss, you know, solely on China and India and the opportunities and challenges.
Thank you. I think we are actually out of time, but I shall ask one political question, because I haven't asked a political question yet, and this from the audience. It is, under Prime Minister Modi, would you say that bilateral ties between Delhi and Beijing have been the strongest ever? And would Beijing have to reassess its proximity to Pakistan for even more enhanced ties with India? It's an interesting question. Maybe, Vijay, would you like to take that?
I would answer the first part of the question, because the second part would be too political to discuss here. The first part, yes, I guess the ties right now are the strongest ever. And in spite of some differences, they are becoming stronger. And we are now better understanding each other, which is a good part to resolve the issues. I won't go into the Pakistan issue.
Okay. You want to say
something? Yeah. You know, China is a reality. $11 trillion, 1.35 billion people. India is a reality. 1.3 billion people, 2.25 trillion, growing at 8%. All right. Asia is a reality. 60% of the world's population, 40% of world GDP, overall growing at 4 to 5%. Now, we have to work together. Yes, China is very fond of Pakistan. It's got a historical relationship. India is mature enough to understand that you can have a relationship with China, and you got to have peace at the border. There's some small irritation that goes on, and I think there's got to be peace in the border. And if you increase trade and commerce between China and India, automatically the Chinese will see India as something they need to invest in, India will see China as something they need to invest in, and Pakistan is a very small economy. And if Pakistan and China have a great relationship, it's fine, it's okay. I mean, no, I don't think we need to be concerned, because we have to live in peace in this part of the world. And both countries have to live together. There has to be cooperation. And the world is big enough for both these countries. So I don't think, I think, you know, it gets blown up because of a small incident. There is history. We have to live through it. We have to accept it. I think we have to grow up.
Right. If I may give the last word to the Chinese side, Mr. Wu, do you feel that the relationship between China and India today is warmer than it has ever been in your experience? I won't put you on the spot to answer the second part. I'll just ask you the first part.
Okay. I try to express my understanding. The relationship among us, IC is very popular in Silicon Valley. And then now I plus C, so India, Pakistan, China. So I plus China equals one community. That's all.
Thank you. Well, on that happy note, I'm afraid I have to call it to a close, but not before we thank our participants. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, distinguished panelists. Now I would like to invite Ambassador Gopinath Pillai to present the tokens of appreciation. Ms. Dai, Mr. Pandey, Mr. Pandey, Mr. Lee, Mr. Khanna, Mr. Pai, Mr. Wu, Thank you. Mr. Srivastava. Mr. Wang. Dr. Chautai Wale. Ladies and gentlemen, our next session is the book launch. May I kindly request you to remain in your seats.